Okay, welcome to Videorial SCR003. In this Videorial, I'll be showing you how to create a cookie picker starter project game using Scratch. The presentation that you can see on the screen at the moment, I will place a link to that in the description below. On slide 3 of this presentation, there is a little folder icon. If you select it and follow the link, it will bring you to a folder where you can find the images that you'll need to create the assets for this project. For this particular project, we are going to need the cookie and each of the pick 1, 2, and 3 SVG files. SVG files are vector-based image files. Vector-based image files are stored mathematically and are just simply smaller and scalable. Anyway, what we're going to do is right mouse click on cookie, download, right mouse click on each of the pick SVG files. Now what will happen is they will download to your designated folder on your computer where you've programmed it or set it to download to. Here you can see them in my downloads folder. Now I'm going to come across to Scratch. Just minimize that. I've already logged in. If you don't have an account, just create one. I think there's usually a little link up here. If you're new to the Scratch website and you don't have an account, a little link comes up that enables you to join. It'll ask you some basic questions. Just complete them and create an account. So once you've created an account and logged in, go to the Create menu option at the top. Okay, now I'm going to automatically, well, every time I create a new project, first thing I do is I give it a name, and I'm going to go File, Save Now. So I've renamed it and I've saved it. I'm going to go across here and I'm going to delete the default cat sprite, and then I'm going to come down bottom right hand corner, just hover over the cat with a plus next to it, and I'm going to upload each of the files, cookie first. That's going to import the cookie image and create a sprite. The default name is the file name itself. So I'm just going to go across and click this button here to zoom out. I'm going to click and drag, and then I'm going to click somewhere in an empty space away from the blue outline, and I'm just going to click and drag until it snaps into the center. Done. Okay, now I'm going to go back down here and upload pick 1 as another new sprite. Okay, now I'm going to go across to costumes and I'm going to upload the other two costumes. Costumes 2. Now I'm hitting Control on my keyboard to select multiple files. Control, click, and then open. And what it's done is it's actually imported them, but it's not in the right order. So I'm just going to click and drag. So now I should have pick 1, pick 2, pick 3. Now I'm going to go to pick 1. Now I'm going to click and drag all of the images. There's about 5 or 6 images in here. The reason why there's a gray square in the background is to enable me to select everything, click and drag everything so that every single one of these costume images is positioned perfectly one over the other, so that I don't get any kind of odd, weird movement when I'm animating the hand actually pinching. Okay. Click. Drag. Okay. That's both of the sprites created. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is go ahead and add the code for the picker sprite. By the way, I'm just going to rename the picker sprite. There we go, picker. I'm going to come across here to the left-hand side, the code tab, and I'm going to start constructing the code. Okay, so when the green flag is pressed, I want it to do a few things. I want it to point in a specific direction, just to sort of rotate the hand a little so it looks a little bit more I'm like realistic in terms of how I'm moving around and picking. I'm going to set the size and then I'm going to make it disappear. Okay, so I'm going to come across here. I'm going to go to events. So when the green flag is clicked, go to motion, point in direction 60 degrees. So that's just going to change its angle a little. And I'm going to go to looks and I'm going to make it hide. Oh, and not forgetting, I want to set the size, I'll just put that in there, to 40% of its current size. Now, when I click the green flag, it's going to disappear. But you can see it's there. And it's slightly more proportional in terms of its relationship to the screen, as you can see. Okay. Okay, now, one of the things that I like to do to avoid issues and problems that Scratch is known for is to control or to set things to happen in a way that I'm in control of. And the way that I do that is I like to create broadcast messages, which basically tell a sprite that it's now okay to do its thing. Okay, so what we're going to do is going to go across to events. And when I receive the message, go underscore picker. Okay, we'll come back to this concept a little bit later and see what triggers this to happen. First thing I want to do, once it's been triggered, is I want to use a variable to, a variable is just like a little place in memory where you can keep things that help you control how things are working. I'm going to create a variable that's going to help me control how and when I can pick and to stop issues with me continually holding down the mouse button, keeping it or avoiding it from keep opening and closing. All right, that would look glitchy. So I'm going to go down to variables and I'm going to actually rename this variable and I'm going to call it picking. So what this is going to do is hopefully just I'll show you as we go along. I'm going to set picking to zero, which effectively means I'm not picking anything up. Okay, then what I want to do is make it go to the front. So that places it at the top. So each of the assets and each of the things within Scratch are placed on top of each other in layers. And all this does is it brings the picker sprite asset to the front. And then I want to reveal it. I want to show it. Okay. And then from that point forward, throughout the duration of the game, forever, I want it to follow the mouse pointer. So go to mouse pointer, and then I want it to actually run another bit of code in what's called a code block. So each time it repeats forever, it's going to go to where the mouse pointer currently is, and then it's going to create or run an extra bit of code, which is actually going to control how it works. Okay. Now, in order to do that, I'm going to come down to blocks. I'm going to make a block called actuate. Just click OK. I'm going to slide that over there and reorganize my sprites. And then I'm going to drag that into there. So just to summarize, when the green flag is pressed, it's going to point or tilt the sprite slightly so it looks more pleasing, resize it to 40, and then it's going to hide it. When it then receives the broadcast message, go picker, it's going to set its picking variable, which controls its motion when you click the mouse. It's going to bring it to the front, display it, and then from that point forward, while the green flag is running and the game is running, it's going to go to the mouse pointer, and then it's going to actuate or run this code, which is going to control how it looks when we interact with it. Right. So first thing I want to do is get it to do something when I click the mouse button. Okay, but I only want it to do it if I click the mouse button and it's not already picking. So I'm going to use an if statement and come down to operators and come to sensing. If the mouse is down and to operators, variable, picking is zero, do something, okay? So what we're going to do is use a code block repeat until. So if the mouse is down and I'm not currently picking something up, what I want it to do is change the costume so it appears like I'm clicking it. So repeat until, use another operator, equals costume number. So come up to here. Let me find, where is it? Costume number here, it's another variable. Costume number equals 3. So when it starts, the costume number is 1. Then when you click the mouse button and you're not picking something up, it's going to go costume 2, costume 3, and it's going to continue changing costumes until costume hits number 3. Now what we want is next costume. Okay. And then it's going to set picking to 1, which effectively means when I click the mouse button and I'm not currently picking something up, go through each of the costumes, making it look like I'm pinching until I get to costume 3. Then we're going to actually stop it doing it again by setting it to picking equals 1. Okay, which effectively stops it repeating that process of going from 1 to 3, 1 to 3. So this kind of constant pinching. Okay, now what we want to do is set the code to stop it when I release the mouse to do the opposite, to go back to being an open. Okay, so we need another if statement. If not mouse down, i.e. if I'm not pressing the mouse button anymore, switch to costume, pick 1. Go to the front and set picking to 0. Okay. Now everything is set and everything is ready to go, but when we click the green flag, nothing will happen because this broadcast message hasn't been broadcast yet. Okay, so now we're going to go across and add the code for the cookie. In the same way that we want to do a few things when the green flag is pressed with the picker, we also want to do a similar thing with the cookie. So first thing that I want to do is set the drag mode to undraggable, and that's really just to try and avoid any kind of glitches with you accidentally touching a cookie with the mouse pointer and somehow picking it up in an incorrect way. I also want to set the size to be 30%. So currently the cookie is way too big, 30%, and I want to hide it. Okay. Now, in the same way that I want to be in control of when certain sprites and when certain blocks of code are executed or run, the same is true of cookie. So I want to actually get it to react when it receives a broadcast message. Okay. Now the broadcast message, you guessed it, is go cookie. So when it receives that message, I want it to prepare itself. Now, in order for cookies to kind of be a bit smart and understand when another cookie has already been picked up and therefore stop itself from being picked up, we're going to use another variable. The variable we're going to make is for all sprites, and it's called handful. And this is just going to allow cookies to see when another cookie's already been picked up. So effectively, the hand can't pick up multiple cookies as it's going along. So first thing it does when it receives the broadcast message is it's going to set handful to 0. i.e. to indicate that no cookie, the hand hasn't picked up a cookie yet. It's then going to create 10 random clones of the cookie. So I'll just drag a repeat 10. And we are going to move to a random position. -220. Oops. I'm going to hit tab on the keyboard just to move across. So between -20 and 220, it will choose a random X position within that range. And then it's going to do the same vertically, -160 to 160. So it's basically going to pick a random position within that range, and then it's going to create a clone of itself. Then once it's created the 10 clones and they're all happily working away, it's then going to broadcast the message that's going to trigger the picker to set itself up. Okay, so all we need to do now with regard to the cookie is tell it what to do when it starts as a clone. Okay, so let's come down here. When I start as a clone, we need to tell it to reveal itself. And then for the duration of its life, forever, we need to give it some kind of intelligence that enables it to react and behave when it's eligible for it to be picked up by the hand. And we're going to do that by adding an if statement. So if certain conditions are true, it will allow itself to be picked up and follow the hand. Okay, so this is going to look quite complicated, but this is just using two and blocks. So first thing we need to do is if the cookie or the clone is in proximity, very close proximity to the mouse pointer. So distance to mouse pointer is less than 4. So if it's within 4 pixels of the mouse pointer position and picking equals 1, i.e. the mouse button has been pushed and the hand is eligible to pick something up. Picking equals 1. And the hand doesn't currently already have a cookie in its grasp, i.e. handful equals 0. If all of these three things are true, so if it's close to the mouse and the hand is picking, i.e. the mouse button has been pushed, and it currently doesn't already have a cookie in its grasp, then it's going to indicate handful equals 1, which means that now a cookie's been selected, and until the hand releases or the mouse button is lifted, it's going to carry out or repeat until these actions. Okay, so while the hand is still picking, i.e. or until picking is 0, i.e. the mouse button has been released, it's going to continually repeat this process. Looks, come to the front, and it's going to go backward 1. So what that basically does is it brings the cookie forward to the front, and then it goes back 1 just behind the hand. So it looks like it's being picked up by the hand, and when you move it across the screen, it sits in front of all of the other cookies. Okay? And finally, we need to tell it to go to picker, which is basically it's going to follow precisely the picker sprite. Okay, now it's going to continually repeat that until I release the mouse. At that point, it then sets handful to 0, which effectively means that another cookie is eligible to pick it for it to be picked up. Okay, so that is the sprite. Everything is now functioning. The final thing we need to do is trigger the chain of events that are going to make the whole game function. So we're going to go across to the stage, code. When the green flag is triggered, it's going to broadcast the message go cookie. Cookie is then going to execute this code and this code and create 10 clones of itself. Once the 10 clones have been created, it's then going to broadcast the message, which is going to trigger the picker, which is then going to run this code. And hopefully, if I now click the green flag, everything should be working. So I'm just going to maximize the screen and go into the game mode, and I'm just going to test it. So I'm going to hover right over the center of a cookie, click and drag. And as you can see, the cookie is, because I changed the order, it now looks like the cookie is above all the other cookies. I'm just going to, oops, you see, I wasn't quite close enough to the cookie. I'm just going to, right, pile them up. That is the end of the tutorial. Now, if anything for you doesn't quite work as you think it should, or as you can see me doing it now, then I suggest you go back and revisit this tutorial and see where you may have made a small mistake. Okay, that's the end of the video. Thanks for watching.